The rocky hills and sagebrush-covered flats at the base of the Sierra Nevada Mountains, extending east to Lone Pine, California, and beyond, have a lengthy and illustrious movie history. For decades, the distinctive contours of these odd-shaped, bronze-colored rocks, backed by Mount Whitney and other majestic snow-covered peaks, have provided a spectacular setting for countless tales of Hollywood's Old West, as well as such far-flung locations as India, China, Afghanistan, and occasionally, even other planets. This sleepy community in California's high desert country lured movie companies because it offered a rugged, romantic mountain setting within a reasonable driving distance of Hollywood. Directors and cinematographers loved filming in the Alabama Hills just west of town, where the distinctive rocks extended far into the distance, offering a perfect way to display motion and distance. The snow-covered white granite Sierra Nevada in the background filled the frame and contrasted perfectly with the darker Alabama hills. From the beginning, many Lone Pine residents worked for the movie companies and support industries, some of them as stuntmen and extras. Initially, rancher Al Gallagher furnished the horses and cattle that filmmakers needed, but it was local rancher Russ Spanhauer who built a business around supplying the movie people with whatever they needed for filming: horses, cattle, wagons, stagecoaches, and other items. He also signed up local residents and cowboys to work on and in the pictures. Eventually, Spanhauer built a Spanish mission set and later added a western town and street set on his Anchor Ranch, a sprawling spread just south of town along Highway 395. By most accounts, the first movie filmed in the Lone Pine area was The Roundup, a Paramount picture starring silent screen comedian Fatty Arbuckle, which began filming in early September of 1919. Then the Hollywood cowboys came, and for nearly 40 years they continued coming, shooting their sagebrush sagas by the dozens. Oftentimes, more than one principal production unit worked in the area at the same time. Among the first Western heroes to utilize Lone Pine locations were Tom Mix, who filmed Just Tony for Fox in 1922, and shortly after, the same studio's rising star, Buck Jones. They were soon followed by Universal Pictures cowboy favorites Hoot Gibson, Ken Maynard, Fred Gilman, Fred Humes, and then Jack Hoxie, who worked here more than any other silent movie cowboy, shooting more than a dozen films in the area during the 20s. The maze of roads winding through the Alabama Hills was originally carved so the movie companies could get their equipment to the various location sites. The first sound film shot at Lone Pine was The Wagon Master, a 1929 Universal Ken Maynard production, which coincidentally was the first sound B Western to feature a cowboy singing. For Song of the West, a 1930 musical western in Technicolor starring John Bowles and Joe E. Brown, Warner Brothers built the first complete town set in the large flat area just north of Movie Road, in the S-curve along Whitney Portal Road. Ever since, the area has been called Red Dog after the town. After the first talkies were made in Lone Pine in 1929 and 1930, the area's movie business really began to pick up. Led by Maynard, Gibson, and Mix, who'd been working there for years, a new group of cowboy stars, studios, and independent production units, large and small, began taking advantage of the spectacular scenery. The newcomers included RKO's Tom Keene and John Wayne, making films initially for First National Warner Brothers and later for Lone Star and Republic Pictures. George O'Brien and Randolph Scott, representing Fox and Paramount respectively, carried on Lone Pine's connection with movies adapted from novels by best-selling Western author Zane Grey. Scott's first trip to the area, to star in Paramount's The Thundering Herd in 1932, began a nearly 30-year relationship with Lone Pine that would not end until his announced retirement upon finishing Comanche Station there in 1960. During the Depression years, independent companies featuring such stars as Bob Steele, Tom Tyler, and Johnny Mack Brown shot movies in the hills and sometimes in the town itself, adding their fare to the seemingly endless stream of B-Westerns required to fill the thousands of theaters that ran Saturday matinees for predominantly young, thrill-hungry audiences.
So this is Lone Pine.
The narrow passes and rugged rocks of the Alabama Hills provide the backdrops for hundreds of westerns featuring the biggest of the cowboy stars, as well as the most obscure. Whether doing the chasing or being chased, the good guys in the white hats were a familiar sight in the Alabama Hills. But it is a good guy wearing a black hat who is most identified with the Lone Pine area: Hopalong Cassidy. For Hoppy, the area stood in for Texas or Old Mexico or Argentina. Or it was Wyoming, where the fictional Bar 20 was located, the opening credits rolling over a pan shot of the Sierra Nevadas as the theme Hills of Old Wyoming played softly in the background. William Boyd made 66 features starring as Hopalong Cassidy, and fully 30 of them were shot in whole or in part around Lone Pine. The other great character most closely identified with the area is the Lone Ranger. In 1938, Republic Pictures chose the Alabama Hills as the setting for its screen adaptation of the adventures of the 30s radio hero, filming what many consider the best movie serial ever made. 80 years later, the location for the key scene in the rocks where the troop of Texas Rangers was ambushed, leaving only one survivor, it's still referred to as Ambush Canyon.
Hear the wind blow, boys. Hear the wind blow. Late in the evening.
Beginning in the mid-30s, with the mushrooming popularity of the singing cowboys, the voices of Gene Autry and Roy Rogers often echoed in the canyons of the Alabama Hills while their production units filmed.
Can't you see me looking through the jailhouse bars?
Pass the hat and collect our pay. Pass the hat and collect our pay. If they ask you where I am, say I'm in an awful jam. Send that pay to the county jail.
Even Tex Ritter made the trip up Highway 395 for a couple of his monogram musical epics.
Oh, we've a lamb, a little black buck, come from Mexico, they say. Come all the way to Texas, just a-looking for a place to stay, just a-looking for a home, just a-looking for a home.
But not all the Hollywood film companies came to Lone Pine to film cowboys. Early on, visiting film crews talked about the spectacularly rugged scenery when they returned to Hollywood. And soon, studio location managers realized that the Sierras could double as other mountain ranges. In the 1930s, actors, stuntmen, and extras garbed themselves as British soldiers protecting the Empire and roamed the Alabama Hills in Lives of a Bengal Lancer, The Charge of the Light Brigade, and Storm Over Bengal. By far the biggest and most important production ever made in the area was the 1939 epic Gunga Din, which starred Cary Grant and Douglas Fairbanks Jr. Filmed almost entirely in the Alabama Hills, it utilized extensive sets built by RKO at great expense, among them an elaborate temple, an entire Hindu town, and a British Army post complete with a parade ground. And for the 10 weeks of shooting, the studio built a huge tent city to house the film crew and technicians, as well as over 900 extras needed throughout the production for huge battle sequences. The 40s began with Tyrone Power and Humphrey Bogart making the trek up from Hollywood. Harry Sherman producing Paramount's last Zane Grey films, as well as Hopalong Cassidy chasing the bad guys through the hills. In 1940, another popular Western character, the Cisco Kid, rode in the shadow of the Sierras. In addition to the Hoppy films, Harry Sherman's production unit filmed a group of historical Westerns, including a remake of The Roundup, the first film shot in the area. During the war years, more than a film a month was shot in and around Lone Pine. Although the end of World War II marked the beginning of the end for B-Western production overall, Lone Pine was at its peak hosting B-units. In 1947, Tim Holt made the first of over 20 Westerns in his RKO series using the hills and mountains of the area as backdrop. Gene Autry continued to be a regular, and of course William Boyd still made the Alabama Hills and the Anchor Ranch home for the Hopalong Cassidy series. However, the last half of the decade saw a gradual shift in Western production from the smaller B units to the larger studio-backed units, which produced more prestigious films that gradually replaced the Saturday matinee fare. John Wayne, by this time an international star, returned to film Tycoon for RKO. Glenn Ford, Gregory Peck, Richard Widmark, and Randolph Scott all made major Westerns in the area during the 40s. By the early 50s, the B Cowboys were about done in the hills. Tim Holt, Gene Autry, and Hopalong Cassidy were supplanted by Randolph Scott and Audie Murphy as the stars who filmed most frequently in the area. Gary Cooper, Glenn Ford, Tyrone Power, and Jack Palance all worked in the area more than once. Lest we forget the ladies, Ann Baxter, Maureen O'Hara, Barbara Stanwyck, Susan Hayward, and Virginia Mayo were a few of the major leading female stars to work there, some more than once. In 1955, MGM brought cast and crew up for Bad Day at Black Rock, the most elaborate production in Lone Pine since Gunga Din in 1939. A complete town set was built to the north and east of town, so only a few key scenes were actually filmed in the Alabama Hills. This film, which stars Spencer Tracy, Robert Ryan, Ernest Borgnine, and Lee Marvin, remains one of the most important and best known of the Lone Pine films because of its wide exposure on television.
Are you still there?
That medium discovered the Alabama Hills in the early 50s. The opening credits for The Lone Ranger, with the William Tell Overture blaring in the background, were filmed on Movie Road. Multiple episodes of Have Gun, Will Travel, Annie Oakley, Gunsmoke, Bonanza, and Rawhide, among many other series, were shot in the area. Even the Twilight Zone made good use of the spectacular scenery offered in the hills. By 1960, with Western series proliferating on television, the market for big screen Westerns had dwindled significantly. Audie Murphy, the last great cowboy star, made his final Lone Pine film early in the decade. Major sequences for 1962's How the West Was Won were filmed in the Alabama Hills, using Movie Road for a spectacular wagon train attack by Indians. In 1972, Clint Eastwood filmed Joe Kidd in the area, but by that time the Western was a dying genre. In recent years, Lone Pine has become a favorite location for producers of science fiction films, most notably Star Trek V and Tremors.
I humbly present the Jericho.
Although movie companies don't come to Lone Pine as often today, the rugged landscape can still be seen regularly as the backdrop for numerous television commercials and print ads. Nearly every make of American car and many European models have been filmed on the back roads of the area. Motorcycle, bank, soft drink, and more recently even candy commercials have been done in the hills. However, today, tomorrow, or 50 years from tomorrow, whenever one thinks about Lone Pine's film heritage, the image that immediately comes to mind will be that of the American movie cowboy.
Everybody knows when you go to the show, you can't take the kids along. You've got to read the paper and know the code of G, P, G, and R, and X. And you got to know what the movie's about before you even go. Tex Ritter's gone and Disney's dead and the screen is filled with sex.
Whatever happened to Randolph Scott riding the trail alone? Whatever happened to Gene and Tex and Roy and Rex the Durango Kid? Oh, whatever happened to Randolph Scott, his horse plain as could be? Whatever happened to Randolph Scott, this happened to the best of me.
Everybody's trying to make a comment about our doubts and fears. True Grit's the only movie I've really understood in years. You've got to take your analyst along to see if it's fit to see. Whatever happened to Randolph Scott has happened to the industry.
Whatever happened to Johnny Mac Brown and Alan Rocky Lane? Whatever happened to Lash LaRue? I'd love to see them again. Whatever happened to Smiley Burnett, Tim Hope, and Gene Autry? Whatever happened to all of these has happened to the best of me. Whatever happened to Randolph Scott has happened to the industry.